हरे कृष्णा प्रभु।
हरे कृष्ण मैम।
हरे और यू वुड यू लाइक टू चैंट बिहाइंड मी और लाइक चैंट ऑन योर ओन? विल डू द चैंटिंग इन द यू नो टू बिगिन विद।
माय प्रोनंसिएशन इज नॉट एज क्लियर एज यू।
दैट्स हाउ वी लर्न। वी चैंट वी द ओके
श्योर नो प्रॉब्लम। I can follow you.
Okay. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Atashri Paramatmane Namaha. Arjuna Vacha. Jayasi Chet Karmanaste. Jayasi Chet Karmanaste. You can repeat now. Jayasi. Can you hear me? Yes.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, I can hear you.
Yeah, one second. Prajesh Prabhu, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. The recording automatically started. Can you just pause it? And Gopika Kanta. Gopika Kanta. Radha Kanta. नमोस्तुते तप्त कांचन गौरंगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये वांचकल्पतारुभ्यस्य कृपासिंधुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्री वासवादि गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Let's pray our respects and obeisance to Radha Krishna devotees. Mangalore ISKCON and our altitude of gratitude to Mangalore ISKCON, Nam Nishtadas Prabhu and all the devotees here. You have been having patience and we'll quickly move on and jump into the dive into the chapter 3. But then before that, just a quick whatever we did on for chapter 2 and Krishna's solutions to Arjuna's objections.
Your screen is not visible.
Oh, okay. Thank you for letting me know. Let me see. Okay. Okay, host disabled participant to screen sharing. It is coming. That's the reason.
Yeah, yes. Mataji, I'll make you the co-host.
Right. Sorry. These are all technical. Okay.
Yeah, Mataji, now we can share.
Yes, okay. Thank you. Just a minute. Now is it visible? No?
No.
Not yet?
Okay. Wait. I think I should have a lot of... Okay. Standbys.
Yes, ma'am, right. It's visible.
It's visible? Okay. Thank you. Yes. So, why Arjuna... Okay, now I have to go over for the... Now, is it visible clearly?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Okay. Thank you, Hare Krishna, for all the devotees. You have been having patience and you are waiting. And so this is a real Karma Kanda. We will get into this Karma Yoga. So, but then before we begin this, once again, our prayers to the devotees as well as Radha Krishna deities gratitude to Mangalore ISKCON Temple and all the devotees here. Krishna's solution to Arjuna's objection. So he was not ready to fight. Okay. So why Arjuna didn't want to fight? It was compassion. And this is what we saw in second chapter. So Krishna has addressed that we are not the body. And he said, no enjoyment. So he said, no, if you fight, then either you get heaven or kingdom. Then he was having that fear of sinful activities. So, you know, when you do any activity, like the example we had Hanuman, we had Vibhishana. So devotional activity is never a sin. You know, just surrender, just leave it to Krishna. Destruction of family tradition. So you need to be a role model to prevent Varna Shankara, that is the children, those who, and the women are not safe. That is what was, you know, all that. And nobody is going to do any austerities if there is Varna Shankara. Then he said, you know, I'm now having indecision. Serve the Lord with firm determination was the answer from Arjuna. So we move on to chapter 3, which is what actually practically you will all be watching and seeing and applying to your own life. That is the yoga of action. We have 43 shlokas in this. Karma yoga, yoga of action. Do you remember what was the first chapter, the name of the first chapter? Anybody can
unmute? Ashtada yoga.
Vishada yoga, all in grief and pain. Then second chapter? Sankhya yoga.
Gita yes, Saramsa.
Yes, so it is like, you know, he is giving all that, but the message was that we are soul, we are eternal, and we have a super soul inside. So every minute he is watching and he's just a spectator, is not into everything. But then we are not this body and we are all conditioned with soul again and again taking birth, and we are here. And Krishna remembers all his past and present and future, but we do not know. We have very short memories. We have just taken this body, and this body is only an instrument. Okay. So now is the one. This is what we all go through, this way or that way, the other way. So I went into all four or five rooms here and there, keeping everything. Is it the internet? Is it the laptop? So 2-3 laptops carry. So, you know, we also do not get. So that happens. That happened to Arjuna. And he said, Arjuna said, like, you know, please ekam vada, just tell me one thing. Tell me one thing that, you know, that I can follow. Now I do not know. So Arjuna asked, should I do fight? He's asking, should I do fight? Because it's a, you know, it's an ocean of material grief. Path of realization is buddhi yoga. The first time we are getting introduced to buddhi yoga. Arjuna thought, intelligence or buddhi yoga in spiritual advancement of knowledge as something like retirement from active life and the practice of penance and austerity at a secluded place. As a sincere student, Arjuna has kept this question to Krishna. So we all know, is it renunciation means do I go in a secluded life and sit? And then, because now you said that intelligence, you know, intelligence means that yoga which is for spiritual advancement. So if I need a spiritual advancement of knowledge, then, you know, I should retire from this active life and go into and just practice penance and austerity at a secluded place. Should I do that? So he's confused. Now the outline for this chapter is, what is it? That what is the confusion? Is it so we all also get, you know, is it like detachment, renunciation, leaving everything? So that was a confusion. Renunciation or work? From the second chapter, he got this confusion, started getting. So fight, do your duty without attachment. But where do you attach? That is from Karma Kanda to Karma Yoga. That is from, you know, third chapter, 10th shloka to 16th shloka, we will know Karma Kanda to Karma Yoga. So the difference also we will know. Act in Nishkama Karma Yoga to set correct example. Then beware of lust and anger. A very important, which is to do with our this body and being in this material world. So is it renunciation? You know, because many times we feel like, oh, withdrawing everything and just sitting is the best thing. No, our soul is so active. Our body has been given as an instrument. So without attachment, but then do attach somewhere else where that affection, admiration, you know, attachment, everything to Krishna. That is what we are going to see. This is a lovely story. You all know. Do you know this? I mean, by this picture, you will know. Our country's name came from him. He is Bharata. Bharatam. Bharata. So that's a beautiful story. And we begin with 3.7. After the sloka, we will, you know, I'll give the story and then we will move on to, okay, 3.7. I know you all have the potential to recite shlokas. Rajshekhar said, Prabhu said, no, it is difficult, but he recited it so beautifully with very good pronunciation. So I would really wish everyone to begin chanting also. Anybody can unmute and chant this. It's a lovely one and we all know it and we keep talking about it. Yes. Anybody who would like to chant?
May I, ma'am?
Please.
Karmendriyani sayamya ya aste manasa smaran इंद्रियार्थान वि मूढात्मा मिथ्याचारः स उच्यते.
Yes, mithyachara. One who restrains the senses, sense organs you have heard, and organs of action, but whose mind dwells on sense objects, certainly deludes himself and is called a pretender. Okay, so jadabharata, jadam is like, you know, without any conscience, but then that is in his three generations have been talked in this story. Now what happens is the king does all the austerities as per this thing, brahmacharya, grahasthashrama, and this king renounces like vanaprastha, like he leaves everything to the family and moves on. So he's doing the austerities, is totally doing those days. They do it. It is very difficult, but today Sankirtana Yajna is the best. That Yajna he went on practicing. So while he was doing his the regular austerities, what happened was there was this deer which was pregnant, and the hunter was behind the deer, and that deer gave birth. He was near the water. Deer gave birth to the smaller deer. Now what happens? He held that deer and he started totally focusing on that deer. So the smaller one. Now he was like, you know, oh my God, if, you know, the deer is hungry, the deer is sleepy, the deer. So everything, the focus for this king who kept left everything to do austerities to Yajna, he was in the Vana, but then he was, his total devotion, total concentration was on him. And then when we will be reading also, we will have that chapter. Where whatever you think, you know, while in the deathbed or while dying, the same you will get that birth. So he becomes a deer, but because of his so much of tapas, so much of yajna, so much of austerities, he remembers his previous birth. And then, you know, that after being born as a deer, then he takes a birth again in a pious family. And where they are very, very rich, this third generation. Okay, now third birth. Now in the third birth is like Jada Bharata. So why is it relevant to this chapter is, he's doing his karmas, he's doing his austerities, he's a very big tapasvi, he went for Vana, but then before this thing, his focus is totally on the deer. So what happens is, for 16 years almost, he has not been talking. But then Bharata laying the... Okay, so on the way, in the third, birth, that on the way, there are people, he has left home and nobody talks to him. Everybody is like against him. He doesn't speak. He eats and he has got a good built body. So when people see the palanquin, the king goes around, and then in the palanquin, the king is sitting. So they're making one person is less and some sickness. So they say, okay, we find a very tough gentleman there sitting under the tree. Let's hold him. So they come and he doesn't speak. So, you know, when he is asked to hold the palanquin, that is the king, on his chariot, on his not a wheel chariot. Okay, so that is palanquin. So first time, and then the king is getting angry because, you know, the palanquin is going, moving. He's also moving here and there. So he says, gets angry and he says, who is this? Why are you doing? So the others say, no, there is another person who is trying to go like this, you know, going up and down and shaking the palanquin. So what happens is, then Bharata, laying the pole of the palanquin down, opened his lips for the first time in his life and spoke. This is a very important thing. That is, whom I'm just, giving the gist. I'm not going to read out the whole thing. Whom are you talking about? The body? Is it the body, or is it the mind? Is it it is. So what do you think it is? He's telling the king. Okay. So the, is this the mass of flesh? It is composed of the same matter as thine, that is like yours, or it is unconscious, it is no weariness, no pain. And if it is the mind is the same as thine, like it is universal. Your mind and my mind is all the same. So if you say that, it is like the is applied to something beyond that, then self. Is it reality? Is it me? Is it self? Then again, the self is also like yours. So it's universe. So the when Bharata started speaking all this, the king realizes, oh, so he's not the same. He's some jnani. He's a super, some soul which has got so much of knowledge. So he says, why I was going here and there? It's not because I was tired. My soul is never tired. I did not want, O king, this body did not want to trample upon the poor worms crawling on the road. And therefore, in trying to avoid them, the palanquin moved unevenly, but the self was never tired. So this is to clearly, this story is relevant to make all of us understand that the soul, the self, is very, very strong, very active, always active, and it is the body which has got something to do with the, it's a conditioned soul, and this body is doing all that is because of the material world, the environment around you. So moving on to now, what is this? If you see the Karma Kanda, when I said it is to do with all those austerities prescribed in Vedas. Okay, so for some fruitive actions, for some benefits. I do this yajna because I want I want some peace. I do this yajna because I need to get a lot of money. I need to get into a bigger house. So I'm doing this. If you do all that, that is, of course, it's prescribed. If you do this sacrifice, this yajna, that yajna, then you get this. So we all know Putra Kameshti Yajna, or all those Rishi Munis have also done, but with some. But if I do the same sacrifice, you know, all for Krishna. So what are we seeing? It's the Vedas, it is all prescribed. Okay, you're doing prescribed duties, then the sacrifice. When we do the sacrifice, the rain comes, and from the rain, the grain. Now from the grain, you know, we all have the food. But if I don't give it to Krishna, if I don't offer, because it's offered from him only, it is offered by that this is a cycle of sacrifice. If I don't give, if I don't offer, before I eat, that's a big sin. If I offer and start eating. So this is the process of our karma yoga. So we need to understand there is sacrifice, there is yajna, which is to be done. And it is never said that don't do it, but do it for Krishna. Do it for, so we will see all in those mantras also. It is always said that it is for Vishnu. Okay. So with this Maha Mantra, so for Kali Yuga, Sankirtana is the best yajna. Okay. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda. You will see all five of them. Shri Vasavadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. And they started chanting. Chanting is the only easiest method. You know, Kali Yuga, life is very short. In this short time, the best yajna, the best sacrifice is your chanting Maha Mantra. So And the okay, now next shloka, Mataji, will you read? Yajna Shishtanya Santo, Uchyante Sarva Kilbisha, Bhujante Tattva Agham Papa, Ye Pachanti Atma Karanat. The devotees of the Lord are released from all kinds of sins because they eat food which is offered first for sacrifice. Others who prepare food for personal sense enjoyment verily eat only sin. This is a very, very important aspect. In every religion, you know, they start thanking, they offer. So it's like this. The father brings, the brother, elder brother brings some sweets, okay? The father brings it for the son. It is his money. He gets the chocolates when he comes back. And when he gives it to the son is very happy. And one of the son brings the chocolate and he offers it to the father. Don't you think the father is going to be very happy with it? It is offered by the father only. But if you still look at him and offer it back to him, just one or a little bit, he's going to be so happy. So we are into the pleasing, or how do I do the service? So whatever I eat, whatever I do, whatever I sacrifice, whatever yajna I do, it is all for Krishna. That is how we can get into. Right now we are into the we have so many things, you know, I need that pleasure. So it's first is the bodily platform. Okay. Then there are people who move on to the sensual platform. My senses needs. So there I get the lust, greed, anger, everything. Then some intellectuals, some sort of, okay, let me think. I have started thinking now, critical thinking, creative thinking. I started deciding for myself. I have started working for myself. Why? Because there is some intellectual, I started using my mental power. Then that is the intellectual platform. Now, if I add on to the spiritual platform, in the beginning also we said intelligent quotient along with your emotional quotient and your spiritual quotient is going to make you nearer and closer. You know, if I would have got perturbed, anxious, maybe like I would have got anger, angry with the AT&T connection or with the internet or with the laptop, and you know, then we go heavy. Little composure, little thinking, we need to work. Krishna, Hare Krishna, what is it that you want? Okay, I'm fine. So I need to give that reinforcement, and that happens only from mental platform, intellectual platform, and connection with the spiritual platform. It sounds, it draws, it is for everything, every activity that we do, that is the one. So, indriyani parane arhu, indriya abhyata parampana, manasastu parabuddhir, yo buddhe parathastu cha. The working senses are superior to dull matter. Mind is higher than the senses. We need to understand. See, our mind is very, very strong. You know, it can travel beyond 9,000 miles. Right now, I can think of, you know, the Delhi house, the Bangalore house, everywhere. So we can travel. The mind has got the higher than the senses. Intelligence is still higher than the mind. And the soul is even higher than the intelligence. So Sri Krishna is advising Arjuna that by controlling the senses, mind and intellect, one can slay this enemy called desire. Enemy is a desire, which is an embodiment of sin. So this is the transcendental knowledge, what we are trying to get into before we actually get into the karma that I am doing, the activity, the action. So body means senses. Senses is controlled by mind. Mind under the control of intelligence. Soul is above intelligence, thus can conquer the lust, which comes from desire. This is transcendental knowledge. That means, you know, it is for attaining. The means of attaining liberation is that transcendental knowledge, that bliss, that knowledge which Krishna is going to give us in detail, you know, that secret knowledge in chapter 9. But if you see, what does this indicate? Before I move on, what is this? What are these horses for?
Yes. These are the senses that are going heavy and that are not in our control.
Very good. Very good. So when all these rains, R-E-I-N-S. Arrange. What is that? Okay,
the person
beautiful.
Who controls all the senses is in is in true control of himself.
Yeah.
Of himself.
Right, right. And behind this person who's having the reins, behind that person, what is that? Okay, that's a soul. Okay.
Okay.
So these senses, that mind, and beyond our control is the mind because of the senses. It's so beautifully expressed here. And so can you see the self and the soul? This is one. This is the intelligence actually, but then I don't know why that is not coming. Here the self. Self is the soul. This is the mind. Okay. It's beyond our control because of all these sense organs. You can see the eyes and nose and ears, hands and tongue. Okay. So now Krishna is also saying, you know, be the role model. Why? Because if you don't do anything, yad yad acharati shreshta tat tad evataro janaha sa yat paramanum kurute lokas tat anuvartate. So people will follow wherever action is performed by great men. Common men will follow in his footsteps. So whatever standards he sets by exemplary acts, all the world pursues. So he leads by an example. Role models shape the society. Janaka Maharaja, you know, didn't have to do everything. Krishna didn't have to do anything. But they all have set and as an example. They were all as an example. They have set an example that, you know, please follow. So if you follow, then the others would follow your, that will be the right path. That's what Krishna is trying to advise and explain through this. This picture is really nice. And I always see these ducks here. They all follow. If the mother jumps into the water, they will follow. So these are all stages of the last. And Mataji, you can read this slokam. Okay. They're all degrees of the last. Yes. Dhume navarate griyate. Mataji. So anybody can unmute and read. Dhumena vriyate.
Ma'am, what is the number of shlok? Because it
Sorry.
Actually, that's the thing.
Okay. So in English, you are not able to read that, right? The number
yes,
of shlok.
Yes.
That is, I understand. That's why you were not unmuting. I was wondering why. I should have noted it down. Can, if anybody can read it from English. Even I find it difficult if it is in Hindi, if it is in English.
Okay, ma'am. I'll
read. Yeah, please. Yeah.
Dumena priyate vahanir yathad yathadash darsho malena cha yathur bena vartu garbha tathade tenedam avartam.
Thank you, Prabhu. These are all the degrees of lust. So the first one is, if you see here, it's the this is the fire, and from fire, dhuma. This is the smoke that is coming. And what is this? This is the dust on the mirror. Okay. So this can be removed. This can be removed, okay, by those austerities. And this fetus inside the mother's womb, that means it's totally in that ignorance, totally inside, means like it's so difficult to come out. Okay, these are all the degrees. Now, this is maybe from those who have sattva can move on and, you know, come out of the smoke. The fire is still there. Fire indicates some the mood of goodness, right? So the mood of goodness and think that this is, you know, that mode of passion and take it like this is totally into mode of ignorance. That is sattva, rajas and tamas. we can compare this, but these are all the degrees of lust we all have. So where are we? We have to ourselves count. Are we inside this, this, or this? And how do I come out? Okay. Yes.
What is the mode of passion?
Mode of passion is Rajas Gunam. Rajas Gunam, we will be doing it in detail. Rajas is like, oh my, I have to do it. I have to get the first. If I don't do it. So, you know, they work very well, but always desiring something, always that anxiety, always that highest degree, not taking things as it is, not taking it as little cool, but taking it as I have to achieve. See, in a way, a little bit that of that anxiety is fine. But then, so the mode of passion, which is Rajas, that Rajas has to be there for Kshatriyas. But along with it, you know, there is a mode of goodness. Krishna is above all three, but we all go through this three. These three really plays a lot of role in our day-to-day life. And every time you act is this mode of goodness. So morning when we get and chant and do everything, even in the data, in the whole day, like, you know, that is the mode of goodness. So, oh, I'm in the mode of goodness. Then afternoon, I need to rush and get the bus and the car is like honking and, you know, I need to do this. I have to be on that sort of an anxiety-driven work. That is that Rajas. And of course, we all need that mode of ignorance where you need to have a good sleep also. So everything is a cycle, but all our behavior and attitude and action, reaction, everything is determined by these three modes. And how we balance it, how we come about, and how we actually get established with the mode of goodness is what is very important. And that's what we will be working on. Okay. So these are all different degrees of lust, as I said. As fire is covered by smoke, as a mirror is covered by dust, or as the embryo is covered by the womb, the living entity is similarly covered by different degrees of the lust. And degrees of the lust is because of these three modes. Okay. So in this, he says renunciation or action. That is, please tell me one thing. Then Nishkama Karma Yoga, which is Niyatam Kuru Karma, Karma Kanda to Karma Yoga. We'll talk about this in little detail. Lead by example. These are all the main points in this third chapter. Okay, so the greatest enemy is what? Iham Vairina. Like, okay, what is Karma Kanda? I just said Karma Kanda is, you know, doing all those austerities, doing all those sacrifices for one's own benefits. But then from there, to move on to Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga, leave everything to Krishna. Leave everything there. You know, saying that, you know what? I have to do all my karma, all my prescribed duties, all my actions and everything, remembering him. You know, the nine ways of bhakti will also be said. So 1 to 6 is totally on karma. How do I do? What do I do? Can I just lead all through my senses? Can I leave it to the senses or use my intelligence or keep hold the reins or control the senses and go into the sattva-guna or use my intelligence, my intellect and my mind to please the soul and super soul. So what is pleasing the soul and super soul is pleasing the super soul. Whatever I do, whatever action I do, it is karma yoga. Yoga itself, vijnana. Vijnana and yoga itself is to path to link with Krishna. Linking process is what we are into. So anything that I do, anything that I, without activity, nobody can do. So it's not renunciation. So I'm not renouncing anything. Then if I don't need to renounce, then what do I do? You keep doing your duties, but leave everything without any fruitive action. So you are entangled and embodied and conditioned soul, but we have set a goal that liberation is the ultimate. Now, if that is the ultimate goal, but all my process, you know, all my senses needs to be in control. Tongue is the worst enemy, okay? So hurting by hand, more than hurting, doing that, tongue. So, you know, speak out the words, which is not going to be really hurting anybody. How do I do that? So being kind. So what is that you know, I don't fall into, then how do I be? So all those virtues needs to be action, feeling, thoughts. So my thought process also needs to be like that. In my mind, I say, think something, and I, in action, I do something. In my talk, in my behavior, in my attitude towards other people, I do something. No, that is into the karma kanda for the benefit, for the fruitive activities. But here, of course, in the fifth chapter, we will go how into karma with the Krishna consciousness, with the jnana. Here, we are just talking about sense control, and the mind and the intellect has to be along with that, and the reins, mainly you do the prescribed duty, but do not have any expectations. Without expectations, how do I do it? So yesterday also there is a question, and Prajesh Prabhu will be sending me those questions, and I will sit and write the answers. So without any, is it like if in my career, I need to work on with a goal setting. So is the difference between expectations, goal setting, and the results, the outcome. So if the outcome is good or bad, accordingly, I will do. So do I do the karma in that way? Or do I just do it for the, because it's been told, because it, this is my duty. So this is where we need to differentiate. Yes, Hare Krishna, why our thoughts and words don't agree together and out? That's a beautiful question. Okay, so thoughts and actions do not match, because our senses take control, the feelings and the emotions. The senses take control because there is a desire. There is a lust. There is a desire. Desire leads to lust. Lust leads to greed. Greed leads to frustration. Frustration leads to anger. So my thought first is, you know, first to get angry on, like morning, whatever episode happened in 5 minutes, moving. So the first thought is, the person who gave the connectivity and the company that gave the connectivity of internet. So that is my thought. And my feeling is, no, this is a test. This is a patience. This is a test for me. I need to be composed. When we are into the Krishna consciousness, when we are into the Bhagavad Gita, that gives little composure, because we start applying. So the thoughts and feelings do not match if we are in the mode of passion and mode of ignorance. If then the mode of that is the goodness, the sattva guna takes over. How does it take over? Only with the practice. Abhyasa, only with the practice. Practice of what? Chanting Mahamantra, sitting and thinking about Krishna at least for 5 minutes, offering whatever you eat before you eat, so offering it to him. Then doing all the duties. So our thoughts and feelings do not match with the actions, because we think something and we start doing something, because the senses take over the control. I mean, the mind is taken over by the senses. Sense gratification is what we all need, and we all do that, the whole. So if we get into the sense gratification, naturally, the thoughts and the feelings and the actions do not match. There is no congruence. The congruence between the thought, action, and feeling is what is going to lead you to the real karma. The real karma in the sense, the real self-realization. And that self-esteem and self-concept enhancement takes you only with the outcome, and the process is through Krishna realization, Krishna consciousness. What is this consciousness? My consciousness within me, he is there. Within me, and he's watching whatever actions, whatever thoughts, whatever. So, you know, DAP is don't analyze people. That is the mantra. That is, if I see a person, he has hurt me so much, I need to give back to him. But the Mahabharata was okay. Yes, Pranjal Mataji or Prabhu, please unmute and speak. It'll be useful for everybody. How to minimize sense gratification and maximize? Wonderful question. How to, Prajesh Prabhu, please note down all this, okay? It is for all our references. We can, yes, please. Thank you. Thank you, Hare Krishna Prabhu. I will be able to answer it slowly, because the pop-up comes only for a few seconds and moves up. And then in the chat box, I need to see. Okay. Mahabharata was for the desire of dynasty. Isn't that the desire? Even Krishna said that you'll either get the rule or heaven. Isn't that a desire? Beautiful. Saloni Mataji. If Yudhishthira, if Panchapandavas do not do their prescribed duty of ruling the kingdom, what would have happened to that kingdom in the Prastha? What would have happened? Anybody can unmute and say. Although this is not Mahabharata class, but then still, if you don't have the kingdom, if you don't have the ruler who goes through the dharma, what will happen to that kingdom? What will happen to the community? What will happen to the society? What will happen to the people there?
Ma'am, all the families of the or of the community will be exploited by the men, and unwanted progeny will rise in that community.
Yes. Yes, that is what Arjuna says. But then Arjuna says that I don't want to fight because the warriors, if they are dead. This here, that desire, they didn't desire. Krishna said that, you know, to stop the adharma. What was Duryodhana and Dushtasana, they were all doing? What was happening to that kingdom? So to stop that, to establish dharma, dharma samsthapanarthaya sambhavam yoga yoga, that's why Krishna comes down. Because that dharma has to be established. So that is the reason. So they didn't mind. He didn't want to fight over. They didn't have that desire. Otherwise, Krishna would not have been with them. Krishna wanted them to fight because last minute also Krishna went as Pandava Duta. He went as a messenger to, and he said, at least give 5 villages. And when Duryodhana said, not even a needle, the whole of the needle, I mean, not even that much I will give. So that is the reason why. So it was not their desire to fight a war, nor desire, they didn't have the desire to even rule the kingdom. If you get into the detail of Mahabharata, you will understand that. Anyhow, so this is Bhagavad Gita class, so I don't want to go into detail about it, but still, yes, this is a very important question. Thank you, Mataji. How to minimize sense gratification and maximize Krishna's gratification? It is very difficult to in the contemporary area. Yes. In the contemporary world, it is very, very difficult. But anything and everything I do, I leave. It is a practice. Okay. It is abhyasa. It doesn't come so. It doesn't really come. Because the moment somebody says something, we get hurt. Because the senses have already taken. The mind has taken that control. If I use the intelligence, it is by slowly, you know, start chanting Maha Mantra. I'm telling you that you will find the difference. I'm getting so angry. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. I do that. I really do that. And I get angry. Okay, I need to control my anger. How do I do that? I need to think, oh, Krishna is residing in it. If he is saying this, I need to empathize with that person. It is not that person whom I hate. It is not what I hate. That hate word will not. I don't like what has been told, what has been said, or what. So the sense gratification, if we go beyond that, if we go behind that, what happens is Krishna doesn't reside. Okay. So it is a difficult thing. Okay. But it is while you do, you keep practicing, it will come. It will come. It will take time, but start practicing. It doesn't come on one day. It takes time. So when a child of 5 years said, you know, what is happening is, can I see Krishna now? Because I'm chanting shlokas. I want to see. Can I see him? Can I see him? Why not? You can see him. So I'll quickly tell a story here. When Mahabharata Kurukshetra war was to happen, everybody was clearing the, naturally the, you know, they go around and see the battlefield, if everything is fine or not. So when that was happening, the trees had all fallen down, and there's one nest has fallen down, and because the elephants are pulling down the trees. So what happens, and sparrow comes around Krishna and speaks to Krishna, says like, you know, you have brought me down. What is going to happen? Because the eggs are being laid, 5 eggs are there inside. Then this is all from, Bhagavatam and Mahabharata stories. So now the sparrows, Krishna says, I can't do anything. It's like karma. It's like, you know, you have to go through the process. The sparrow takes around parikrama of Krishna and says, I don't know. I have left it to you. If you want to kill us, you kill. If you want to kill my, the smaller ones, it's up to you. But I don't know. I know only you. So what happens is Krishna is asking Arjuna to give his Gandiva. So Arjuna thinks, oh, you tell me, I will do it. Krishna says, no, you give it to me. So he says that elephant had pulled down that tree and the nest has fallen. So when he throws the arrow, Krishna tells the sparrow also, you know, have the food for 14, 15 days. The bell falls on the nest. Okay. That's it. So Arjuna thinks, oh, Krishna could not even throw the arrow in a proper way. He didn't kill the elephant and only the bell fell down. What happens after 18 days, after the war, you know, when they come back to, then he takes out the bell and so Arjuna understands. Now the sparrow, there are five small sparrows, they fly off. And the mother sparrow just again does a parikrama and gives the obeisance to Krishna and goes off. What does it indicate? What does it indicate? There was in the war front, there was such a big terror and for that trauma, you know, that trauma, what was happening. But the sparrow totally surrendered. So slowly and gradually for sense gratification, Ataji, anything and everything. I am seeing something. No, I don't want to see. That sort of a mind and intellect has to take over your senses. No, I will not. Saying no is very difficult for all of us. You know, that is where this practice of being in the spiritual platform helps us. Saying no to alcohol, saying no to the peer pressure, saying no, it's a small, small thing. But learn, we are learning. It's all a learning process. The outcome will be beautiful. You will experience the ecstasy in the Krishna consciousness that you will think, oh, this is all material, but nothing. It is not arrogance, okay? It's being assertive to say no. So there is a very small difference between arrogance and assertiveness. So we will not have that arrogance, but we will actually practice being assertive. That will bring the sense the senses into control. Okay. I think I answered, but then I will also write to you. Yes. Thank you. Hare Krishna. Any other question if you have? But start chanting Maha Mantra. You will enjoy it. Anytime you get anger, any feeling, any thought process which you feel is negative, which is not positive, which is not as per prescribed, if I have to follow this path. And be with us when we do it in detail, every shloka. See, here in the first level, we just select 3, 4, 5 shlokas and the gist and the theme is only, talked about. Like first we said about how he was in grief and how he is trembling. Then Krishna is telling Sankhya Yoga, it's only the body which is destroyed, which will otherwise also happen. Then slowly, you do your duty, you control your senses, you know, gratification of the senses is what is creating all these issues and concerns and the problems. So the lust, greed and anger is the hell, is the gateway for the hell. So, you know, come out of it. So these are small, small things. We are really enjoying each other. Oh, thank you, Prabhu. Thank you, Mataji. Shiri, okay. How to overcome loneliness? Okay. Ravi Prabha, if you think that, you know, you can get into the association of the devotees, linking with the people whom are like-minded is always good. Satsangha. That sangha is important. How do I get into the sangha? Whomsoever you feel, you know, they are like-mindedness. I told you about my childhood experience also. I used to rush to the temple and sit there and chant. It's not that always you need to be chanting, but doing small, small services, whichever gives you happiness, will also make you feel that you're not lonely. Okay? So, yes. Yes, I understand. I often get anxious about my parents' health. In the era, nothing is certain. In the back of my mind, I'm always surrounded by the fear of losing someone I love. How to overcome that? Yes, Ananya Mataji, I understand losing or even separation or even, distancing. All this is painful. It is very painful, even if you think of it. The first thing Krishna says, leave the fear. When we know we have four things, birth, okay, growing up, old age, sickness, diseases, and death is all certain. Which, when Yaksha Prajna Yudhishthira was asked by Dharmaraja, when Yamaraja, so in that, when all his brothers died, what is that, which is very funny, the worst thing is, we don't accept what is to be, what is real, what is reality. The reality is, old age will set in, diseases will come. And I am not saying death is certain for anybody, any age. So that fear inside us really kills us more than what we really to face the reality. And you take care of the parents and be nice and be kind. Be helpful in all aspects. And that's it. Leave it to Krishna. Leave it to Krishna. Don't have that fear. But that happens only when you get connected. That connection with the super soul will make you strong. First chapter itself, we said, Guda Kesha, what is this? Why are you having this fear? Why are you so weak? Karpanya dosha bahada swabhava. Even Arjuna says, I'm weak. I'm very tired. I'm weak. So here, Jadabharada, you saw that it is not the weakness of the soul. It is the weakness of the body that made him to tremble. So they're all examples from Srimad Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita. There are a lot of examples. Okay, but I will write it detail. Okay, Mataji, how to overcome distractions when we are studying? Yes, that's a very, very important. Take a break, 5 minutes. You set a time, have a time management, 40 minutes, 45 minutes. Beyond that, the brain needs some sort of a relaxation. So 5 to 10 minutes, not more than that. Take any pleasing activity, I'm not saying only this. So whatever gives you good pleasing moment, 5-10 minutes. After 45 minutes, why our class periods in the schools also, we have like that. In the colleges also, we have like, not beyond, beyond 1 hour, the retention power will reduce. So that's the capacity of the brain. So what you do, 10-15 minutes, take a break, go around, then come back. And then you will not get distracted. You will see that your focus will be more on that. But try, everything is a trial and error basis only, because every person, every individual is different. Everybody, that same ingredient, same therapy will not help. But then slowly and gradually, this is working for me. This is working for me. Take a walk, take a break, call up somebody whom you feel, and then read something else, read a poetry, write a story. Anything can be done to bring back your diversion. Okay, so distractions. But then there are a lot of ways to do that. Mrityunjay Tiwari, is it Prabhu? Mataji, Prabhu, I think. Okay. So, but I will write. Okay, these questions are very, very important. I'll write you the time management and how to get back from distraction. Ma'am, yes. How to yes.
I have a question.
Yes, please.
Ma'am, normally, when we talk of a prescribed duty, particularly, so as a student, the prescribed duty is to study well. But you also know that not everyone is well in studying. Someone is average, and 5% of them are toppers, and rest all in average, the rest are below average. So, ma'am, as a student, we sometimes tend to give our best, but then also we end up, having that average kind of marks. And sometimes the student is good in sports and extracurricular activities, what he enjoys doing, not studies like what he enjoys doing.
Correct.
So, ma'am, in that case, should anyone, as a prescribed duty, can we say particularly that as a student, that it is your responsibility to study first and then play, or something kind of that.
100% right. The prescribed duty for a student is to study. It's to study well. And now, if I have like 5 homeworks and tomorrow I'm due for submission of a project also, I need to work for it. And that will have the dividend on its own. That will have, because you earn a lot. A lot of earning is important. And how do we earn? Why it is important? Because we will come to say, 50% for charity, 20% for yourself, 5% for, So if you have to earn, then you are asked, your parents are asking you to study well. So when the studying well comes, which means you cannot get distracted, you cannot get diverted. We need to do our duty as a student. There is no two ways about it. But getting the marks, whether 90 or 80 or 70, is up to the, your own karmas, your own. But you are doing the best. So what happened was, I will share my experience. Out of 60 students, I was in the 15th or 16th, never on the first, okay? So, what happened in the, we had 12th grade, I talked and everybody was asleep. But then I still remember 3 a.m. sitting like this and no tea, nothing, hot water my mother would give. But then I had a Krishna picture in front of me. Krishna, what is this? What is this? It's not because of Krishna I got the first. It is not because of, but it both together, that IQ and EQ, what I'm saying is that SQ. So prescribed duty for a student is to study well. There is no doubt. We need to work hard and it will have. So 80 or 85 or 90 is up to the what we have brought it with us. Okay. But you do the best, you are going to get the result. Not expecting that I am, yes, as a student, I will expect 100. Okay. That doesn't mean that your control of senses is not there or your gratification of self. That is, but if I'm studying and I see a movie or a serial and I go and sit there for hours together, then it is total distraction and it is not, I'm not doing the prescribed duty. You understand? I'm not saying 24/7 you need to study, but then you have to. Getting the marks and getting, okay, sports can be, cannot be a career. If you think, then it cannot be. But if you are making it as a career, so, this is a career counseling from Bhagavad Gita, we will shift to career counseling, but still I will write, okay, I'll write the steps for that. Why do good people suffer? I don't know, Prabhu, if I answered. Why do good people suffer? Yes. Why younger generation children suffer fatal diseases? Everything happens for a reason, but I'm unable to see the reason behind this. Yes. Ananya Mataji, you asked a very, very subtle question. You will see how the fetus gets into and how you all are biology students, and we will also see in Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, see today only your CT scan and all is there, but Bhagavatam talks about every month progress inside the in mother's womb. So what happened was, till 7th month inside, I don't want to be born. I don't want to, because that fetus remembers everything, okay? Generation after generation. There are prarabdha karma and sanchita karma, all accumulated karma. So everything, the soul is like, it's a chip, it's an MB-RAM. They all have the memories. So whatever karmas we have done, we need to, have to experience that. Okay, there is no two ways about it. So the suffering, good people, yes, they have taken into the mode of goodness now. But what had been accumulated before, we don't know. The past memories are not there. Unfortunately, the people around the purple suffering also gets into this. It is their karma again. That is why this karma yoga, when I know everything that I will be carrying on this to my next birth, which I don't want. So liberation, ultimate is liberation from this death birth cycle. Do I carry all my sins? along with me for the next. So that suffering happens. Now, today I am good. I know I'm connected with the super soul. I know for sure I will, wherever I leave my body, that is where I will begin with it if I take another body. Okay. So these things happen. And the reason is, it is not he desired. We desired to come here. We wanted to come here. We are doing certain activities, and that activities have, we are more than the time. Otherwise, there is one story I wanted to tell. Anyhow, so one Brahmin was, you know, very good in charity. So he was like annadana. He was doing all that food distribution to the people who were coming. So everything was being given. One day what happened was, there was an eagle in the mouth, there was a snake, and the snake venom came out because the eagle is carrying the snake. The venom came out and it fell down on the food. So the food got poisoned, and everybody who was over ate, that was all poisoned. Then Yamadharma Raja, Yamadutas asked, you know, who should be punished? Is it the person who distributed the food? Is it the eagle? Is it the snake? Then who? So Yamadharma Raja did not have any answer. And after a month or so, there was a traveler who said, you know, there is a person who gives annadanam. I wanted to eat because I'm traveling from this place to this place. So there, that's one lady comes and says, oh, the person who killed 100 people. Yamadharma Raja said, okay, you know, she will get all the sins. What does that mean? So anything and everything from our tongue, from our action, from our feelings, from our thought is all written. Chittar Gupta, you know, he writes, there is a Gupta Chitra also inside. Everything is written as our karma. Okay. So Ananya Mataji, I don't know whether I've answered with this. I will stop here, but I will answer all your questions in papers for references. Okay. But these answers are there in Bhagavad Gita in the coming subsequent chapters. Do not leave us. I'm again and again requesting you all, keep listening, because this is a journey which will really give a lot of answers to you. And don't leave us. This group is very important. We go into level 2, where we have a detailed study of all the shlokas, 700 shlokas, which was recited in 40 minutes. And when, you know, we are all in the position of Arjuna. Arjuna is a great warrior, okay? He's a great intellectual. He had all the sense control also. But he, on behalf of us, he asked. That's how I can say. I will stop here. And today, 18 times you will chant Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, and try to chant by the books. You know, we do Sankirtana, 5 minutes. Spend time for yourself. Sit and meditate. Meditate means it is not possible unless and until you openly chant a little louder. That will not make you sleep, and that will not make you think about other things. Yes, Prabhu. Thank you, Hare Krishna. So I'll stop here. And Prajesh Prabhu, you can start. Yes. Thank you.
Yes,
Hare Krishna to all of you. Shri Chaitanya.
Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare. Hare Krishna, thank you. Thank you, everybody. Hare Krishna.